Good evening. I want to welcome you and thank you all for joining us this evening. I'm Charlene Brown, Executive Director of the Castle Hill YMCA, and I'm thrilled to be here with you. For the past several years, the Y has been promoting civic participation as a way that people can help strengthen their communities. The 2021 elections will have a tremendous impact on the future of New York City, and the Y is committed to helping prepare our communities to take part. Trustworthy, nonpartisan information is essential to helping New Yorkers exercise our right to vote. In recent years, primary elections have played a huge role in determining who gets into office in New York City. New York is now using ranked choice voting for many city races in primary and special elections. This year, the primaries will take place on June 22nd, with early voting from June 12th to June 20th. And we want voters to be informed and ready. To tell you all about ranked choice voting, we have Raul Pichardo and Julia Rivera from the LEO Educational Fund. Founded in 1981, the LEO is the nation's leading 501c3 nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that facilitates full Latino participation in the American political process. From citizenship to public service, the LEO provides national leadership on key issues that affect Latino participation in our political process, including immigration and naturalization, voting rights, election reform, the census, and the appointment of qualified Latinos to top executive positions. In recent years, the LEO has partnered with the Y to lead outreach on the census, educate teens on civic engagement, and host voter registration drives at our branches. Raul and Julio, thank you so much for being here. I encourage people to use the Q&A function to submit questions that come up as you listen to Raul and Julio's presentation.
Great. Thank you very much, Charlene. It's great to be here. Great to be able to talk about ranked choice voting and the changes that are coming to this year's election. And without further ado, Julio, can you take us on to the next slide, please? In today's presentation, we're going to be talking about what is ranked choice voting, how it works, and as well as the upcoming elections and an opportunity for open discussion and questions. Next slide, please. And Charlene very kindly introduced organization. And just quickly, NALEO is established in 1981. We have offices throughout the country, including California, Texas, Florida, North Carolina, Washington, DC, and New York. And as she mentioned, we work on a variety of issues, including elections, citizenship, and other forms of public service. Next slide, please. One such issue and campaign that we work on is our Ve y Vota campaign. This is a nonpartisan, comprehensive civic participation strategy designed to remove barriers to full Latino electoral participation. We know that our community trusts us to provide them accurate information. And so as part of this campaign, we have our Ve y Vota hotline, which is at the 1-888-VE-Y-VOTA. It can take questions year round from anywhere in the country about elections that are taking place in our communities. Next slide, please. Great, so let's talk about ranked choice voting. Next slide. Ranked choice voting is a new way for voters to elect their city representatives. Voters will now have the option to rank up to 5 candidates in their order of preference instead of just choosing one in some elections. We see here in this example that we have candidate A, B, C, D, and E. This person chose candidate B as their first choice. Previously, that would have been the only vote that they cast. But now in the elections that will have ranked choice voting, this person will have the option to, again, rank their second choice candidate, which here was candidate C, their third choice candidate, which is candidate A, and so on. So there is an opportunity to pick more than one candidate in the order of preference. Next slide, please. Now, ranked choice voting was not just invented, you know, this year and in New York. It already exists across the country, including in 17 US cities and the states of Maine and Alaska. It's used for municipal elections, school board elections, local party elections, and so on. Next slide, please. Now, for New York City specifically, in 2019, New Yorkers voted in favor of ballot question number one to establish ranked choice voting in the primary and special elections for local office. This was set to become effective January 1st, 2021, so the beginning of this year. And in that election, about 73.5% of New York City voters voted yes. And that's how we have ranked choice voting now in some elections. Next slide, please. Now, very importantly for a voter, when you go into the voting booth, you wanna know if you're voting in an election that will be using the ranked choice voting system, or if you're voting in a more, in a traditional type of election. So for this year and beyond, the offices that will have ranked choice voting are gonna be special and primary elections for mayor, public advocate, controller, borough president, and city council. The offices where you're not going to use this is, for example, not just offices, but the general elections, usually in November, federal or state elected offices, for example, your congressperson, your US senator, when you're voting for president, and then local races like district attorney and judgeships, those are also going to use the traditional way of voting, not ranked choice voting. So it's important to know the difference before you head into the voting booth or before you submit your ballot. Next slide. Now, the elections that I was just referencing, the ones that will not change, are going to be continue to use single choice plurality elections. That's the name of them. Voters choose only one candidate for each office, and the candidate with the highest number of votes will win. The winner doesn't always receive a majority of the vote. They could win with less than 50%. And it will, again, continue to be used in some type of elections, including general, federal, and state elections. Next slide, please. So one of the reasons or one of the things that will become due to ranked choice voting is that runoff elections will be eliminated. You're going to have instant runoffs. So voters will not have to go and vote again in these special and primary elections that used ranked choice voting. And advocates say that this is a positive thing because runoff elections were low turnout, they were costly, and they prevented some voters from participating, including military and overseas voters who might not have enough time to request a ballot and return an absentee ballot by the time the runoff election took place. Next slide. Now, again, what advocates will say are some other benefits of RCV are that voters have more say in who gets elected. Since they're voting not just for one candidate, but they have an option to rank candidates in their order of preference, they may end up voting for the winner, even if it wasn't their first option. Candidates are also more likely to appeal to a wider audience since they cannot, you know, win an election just with the group of their hardest, you know, staunchest supporters. They're going to have to be somebody's second or third choice to remain a part of the instant runoff. And lastly, they'll say that voters elect more diverse candidates. We've seen that in some cases when ranked choice voting is implemented in certain cities, that can result in more diverse candidates getting elected. Next slide, please. Great, and for this section, I'm gonna turn it over to my colleague Julio to tell us a little bit about how RCV works more in detail. Julio.
Great, thank you so much, Raul. We are gonna get into the details on how ranked choice voting works, how to fill out your ballot, how winners are determined. But before that, we're gonna take a quick detour into a short video that explains the process. There.
Hey, NYC voters. For 2021, the City of New York will use the new ranked choice voting method for all NYC primaries and special elections. Here's how it works. You can rank up to 5 candidates in order of preference. Pick your first choice candidate and fill in the oval next to their name under the first column. use the second column for your next choice, and so on, until you've ranked all your preferred candidates. Be sure to mark at least one candidate for your vote to count. You do not have to rank all candidates. Just remember, you can only choose one candidate for each column, and you cannot rank the same candidate more than once. For more information, go to vote.nyc.
Perfect. So hope that gives you a good sense of what to expect when it comes to ranked choice voting. But if not, we're going to get into the weeds a little bit. So first, some instructions on filling out the ballot. As a recap of the video, you'll first pick your first choice candidate and completely fill in the oval next to their name under the first column. And so you can see here again, as Roel explained, this voter voted for candidate B as their number one choice. And you'll just repeat that same process depending on what ranking you want to give each candidate. One thing to remember, like the video explained, is you'll want to fill out one bubble per name and one bubble per column. So that's key. Another key point is you can only rank up to five candidates. So you have some options. You can rank up to five. You have to at least vote for one, but you can also just vote for as many as you'd like between those two, right? If there's only two or three candidates that you do want to support, you have the flexibility to choose just those candidates as well. For write-in candidates, that is still absolutely an option. Every candidate that qualifies for the ballot, their name will appear. But if you want to support a candidate that is not on the ballot, you can write in that name in the write-in field as the last row. One other thing to remember is that you'll need to as well rank that candidate. So it's not enough just to write that person's name, but you'll need to make sure to also give that person a ranking. To provide a sample of what the ballot will look like this June, this is a sample ballot that was provided from the special election in Council District 15 earlier this year. So we've already had a couple of special elections here in New York City this year using ranked choice voting. And this is what the ballot looked like in the Bronx earlier this year. So you can see the names of the candidates, just like in the sample on the left-hand column, up at the top along the different columns, you can see the first, second, third, fourth, fifth choices. In this example, the ballot is in English and in Spanish. That's just determined by your election district or your assembly district, depending on your community's language needs. The languages supported will look a little bit different. Some key issues and mistakes to keep in mind or to avoid. First, don't give multiple candidates the same rank. So you can see in this example that the voter voted for both candidate B and candidate C. If you were to think about this for a moment, you wouldn't be able to determine who this voter actually wanted to support. Was it candidate B or was it candidate C? Because the Board of Elections can't make that determination either, this actually invalidates this ballot. If a voter were to go and submit this to a voting machine, the machine will actually let them know that there's a mistake, and that'll give them the opportunity to talk to an election worker or a poll site worker and request a new ballot. But we want you all to be experts. We want your communities to be experts and to avoid that mistake or any potential issues, making sure that your vote is counted. So again, just a reminder from the video, only one bubble filled in per column and only one bubble filled in per name. The other common mistake that we may see is voters doing what's known as duplicate ranking. This is when a voter ranks a candidate more than once. So in this example, again, you can see candidate B is ranked as the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth choices. This will still actually be counted as a valid vote though. So if a voter were to submit this to a voting machine, it would be accepted with no issues and it wouldn't notify them that there's an error. It'll just essentially be counted as if the voter had only voted for candidate B as their one and only choice. So the issue here is that the voter hasn't taken full advantage of ranked choice voting and the different options that it allows them. And we'll get into a little bit later as to why it is important to use all those different options. We're gonna go into how winners are determined and how the votes are tabulated. So we'll try to keep this as simple and as easy as possible to follow, starting off with a pretty simple example, actually. So in a lot of cases, a candidate will actually win right off the bat. A candidate just needs to receive more than 50% of the votes in order to be declared the winner of the election. So we can see here in this example that candidate B has done that. They've got 54% of the votes, and that means the election's over. Just like in any other election, this is how ranked choice voting would work. But in a lot of cases, no candidate will receive more than 50% of the vote. So in this case, we'll need to actually start eliminating the candidate that has received the lowest number of votes. To make things a little bit more simple and easy to follow along, we're actually going to use this ballot as an example on our left-hand side. So you can see in this example that the voter has voted for candidate D as their number one choice, but you can also see that candidate D has actually received the lowest number of votes of any of the candidates. So we'll need to now look at our voter's second choice pick and redistribute that vote to their second choice pick. We do that for all of the votes, voters that voted for candidate D as their number one choice. In our example, our voter voted for candidate C as their second choice, so that vote goes to candidate C, but depending on how voters voted as their second choice pick, those votes get redistributed to their next highest ranked candidate. Once we do that redistribution process, we calculate the new totals, and this is what we're left with. Candidate A has 31%, candidate B has 45%, candidate C now has 24%. But like I mentioned before, a candidate needs to receive more than 50% of the vote in order to actually win this election. So we're gonna continue this process until somebody does. So again, each round, we just eliminate the candidate that has received the lowest number of votes. In this case, it's going to now be candidate C that gets eliminated. Again, our voter voted for candidate C as their second choice pick, so we now have to look at their third choice pick. Once those votes get redistributed, again, our vote now goes over to candidate B. We calculate the new totals, and now, of course, since we only have two candidates, one of them has to get more than half of the votes. And that candidate is candidate B in this case. So that's it. That's the process that takes place behind the scenes. One thing for voters to know is you don't have to memorize this. You don't have to actually know how all of this works and how all the votes get tabulated. But this is what's happening, and this is how we actually determine who the winner of the ranked choice voting elections will be. So I will point out that because our voter used all of their rankings, they voted for candidate B, they actually ended up helping determine who won this election, and they actually ended up voting for the ultimate winner of this election. So that's the strength of using all of your rankings, because if our voter hadn't done that and had only voted for candidate D, they wouldn't have played a role in any of the preceding rounds or determining who actually wins this election. So again, that's the beauty of ranked choice voting and one of the strengths of using all of your rankings and options. So it's a key takeaways for folks. First up, voters can rank up to five candidates, but they do not need to rank a total of five candidates. Again, we mentioned ranked choice voting is flexible. You have to vote at least for one and up to five, but again, you can vote for as many as you'd like between that. Only the vote for the candidate in the highest position has not been eliminated counts. So we were always only looking at the voter's highest ranked choice until they were eliminated. And if your main candidate is eliminated, your vote goes towards the next highest ranked candidate on your ballot. A word about election results and when to expect them. First off, as we saw in 2020, it sometimes takes some time for us to actually determine who won an election. Take days, if not weeks, if not more than a month. That's going to be the case with ranked choice voting as well. And that's really just the new reality of our elections. We're no longer in the days of election night results. The BOE has to accept some absentee ballots up to 10 days after the election, and they can only start doing this whole tabulation and elimination process once they've counted all of those votes. But rest assured that that's just a part of the process and making sure that all the votes are counted so we can get some accurate results. So with that, I will turn it over back to my colleague, Raul, to tell us a little bit more about the upcoming election and some additional resources.
Sounds great. Thank you, Julio. Next slide, please. Great. So the elections that are coming up, the citywide primary elections, are going to take place on June 22nd. Early voting will take place between June 12th to June 20th. All voters registered to a political party holding a primary will be able to vote in that party's primary. And importantly, again, the seats that are up for election are the mayor, public advocate, controller, the five borough presidents, and the 51 city councils. This is a very important election because there's gonna be a lot of incumbents that are termed out in New York City. So here's an opportunity to kind of reshape the political map of the city, choose new leaders that will help lead the city forward. Next slide, please. And there are three ways to do it. Early voting, vote by mail, and election day. So let's talk about those. Next slide. Early voting, again, is going to begin 10 days before election day, and it ends on the Sunday before election day. So for this primary, that's gonna be June 12th to June 20th. And early voting sites can actually be different than your election day polling site. You can find out what your early voting site is at findmypollsite.vote.nyc, or you can also call at 1-866-VOTE-NYC. This is important because there might be a case where you remember your polling place from your previous election and you show up to vote early and the location isn't there. So we don't want people to be discouraged. It's better if they do the research beforehand to find out where their early voting location is, and vice versa. If you do the research, you find your polling place for early voting and you don't vote early, you go on election day and that polling place is no longer your polling place. So you want to make sure you have the right location before you head to any of this early voting or in-person election day voting. Next slide, please. Now you do also have the option to vote by mail, also known as absentee ballot. Due to COVID-19, all New York City voters can request an absentee ballot, which might not have been the case before. You can do so at newyorkcityabsentee.com. You have to make sure that you do that by June 15th. Also, you'll need to check the box for temporary illness as you're filling out the absentee ballot request form. Next slide, please. And there are certain options to where you can drop off your absentee ballot. So if you don't mail it with traditional mail, you can drop it off at an early voting poll site, again, from June 12th to June 20th. You can also drop it off on election day, June 22nd, between 6 and 9 at any election day poll site. And you also have the option to drop it off at any New York City Board of Elections office through election day. So there's a lot of ways to drop off your ballot if you're not going with traditional mail. Next slide, please. Now on election day, the polling places will be open between 6 to 9. You can see your sample ballot. You can again find your polling place at findmypollsite.vote.nyc. And a couple of tips, you know, that we thought about because, you know, of COVID concerns is that if you do feel sick, you wanna make sure to avoid the polls and actually vote absentee. If you are going in person, wear your mask and your gloves, bring your own blank ink pen. You know, that way you don't have to touch pens that maybe other people have been touching. You bring your own hand sanitizer to use before and after voting. Again, you will kind of be encountering just naturally perhaps doors, buttons, other things that people have touched. So just to be safe. And you wanna keep social distance when voting. You're more likely gonna see some markers on the floor to keep that distance between voters. So just kind of maintain that again, just to feel safer. Next slide, please. And we did wanna share our voter information and voter protection hotline, our Ve y Vota hotline, which is 1-888-VE-VOTA, also 839-8682. If you do search hashtag Ve y Vota through social media, you'll also find some more information about our hotline. We're open Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. It is a nonpartisan hotline, so we're not able to tell you or give you recommendations on, you know, which candidates you should vote for. We can only tell you, you know, the positions that are up for election. We are bilingual, so we have operators who can talk to you in English and Spanish. And we train our operators on specific elections because we take calls nationwide. Before an election like this primary election in New York, we do make sure that our operators are trained and so they're able to answer any questions related to this election. And also know we do have operators located in New York City as well. But you know, you might have one of them answer, you might have someone in California or Texas answered. They're prepared to help any, with you with the, any concerns you may have on election day or before. And I think that was the last slide on this session. And so I will pass it back to Julio.
All right, perfect. Well, thank you so much, Raul, and thank you to the Y for asking us to be here today. I can turn it back over to Charlene in case there's any other questions that we may want to be able to answer for folks.
Okay, thank you. We do have a question. The question is, do I have to rank a total of 5 candidates?
Absolutely not. As we mentioned during the presentation, ranked choice voting is flexible, so you can rank up to 5, and we absolutely do encourage folks to use all of the rankings, but only do so if you actually do support that candidate, right? The piece of advice that we always share with folks is only vote for candidates that you actually support and you actually like. So you have options up to 5, but you don't necessarily have to use all 5.
Okay, that's great. So another question, if I rank 5 candidates, do 5 votes get counted?
So as we mentioned, you only have 1 active vote at a time, right? As we went through in the example, we were only looking and only considering the top ranking that the voter had on their ballot, as long as that candidate was still, hadn't been eliminated. So no, you do have 5 options and you do have 5 rankings, but only 1 vote gets counted at a time.
Okay, thank you. So we know that this ranked voting is new, and if I make a mistake, will the machine let me know that I made a mistake?
So for errors, the only error that the voting machine will alert you to will be if you voted for more than 1 candidate under the same ranking. So as we saw in the first example of the error, the voter had voted for 2 different candidates as their number 1 choice. So that doesn't count, that's not a valid selection. So the Board of Elections would actually invalidate that ballot. We want folks to be safe and secure in making sure that their vote is counted. So we want to make sure that folks are aware of that and they avoid that mistake just in case it somehow slips through. But the voting machine should let you know if you've committed an error, and you would then have the opportunity to ask for a new ballot. But as we also mentioned, there are other mistakes such as ranking for 1 candidate, multiple rankings, where it wouldn't actually count as a mistake and you wouldn't be alerted to that. So again, that's an issue that we want to provide this information on and make sure that voters are aware of it so they can avoid it.
Okay. All right. So, well, that's it for the questions that I have. And I am just so glad that we had this time to for all of us to get together here. So thank you, Raul and Julio, for all the information you shared with us. That information definitely would be helpful. And I want to thank everybody for joining us that did get a chance to join us this evening. We hope we can count on you to make voting part of your plan for June and to help spread the word to others about ranked choice voting and the importance of the primaries on June 22nd. For more information on ranked choice voting and other voting resources, and to see a recording of this and other webinars, please visit ymcanyc.org/events/voting. Thank you.
Thank you so much.